Okay. Hello, everyone. Here is Darek Zabrocki, Peter Mohrbacher, and Wojtek.
Hi, guys.
Hey there.
We are pretty happy to invite Peter to this session because he's going to make some demo. You probably know his work from Wizard of the Coast and all the magic stuff. He's pretty brilliant. I met him when I was in LA. So we get in touch, and we think that this session is going to be, you know, pretty fine, because we make a good contact, and Peter was pretty open to join us today. So we hope you like it. And yeah, I think I can introduce his work. Just give him a voice. So Peter, let's introduce you yourself.
Okay. Yeah. So I'm Pete Mohrbacher. I've been doing this this sort of art commercially for about 7 years or so. I worked at CCP Games in Atlanta on a upcoming MMO that hasn't come out yet. And then I also worked in San Francisco at a company called Kabam, the art lead on a game called Dragons of Atlantis. And a lot of people know my work from me doing Magic cards over the past 3 or 4 years. I've been on the packaging a couple of times, and I've done concept art for them as well. So I helped design Return to Ravnica as well as Theros. And you know, if you're a Magic fan right now, they just spoiled my latest card. The latest one they spoiled was Mogus, God of War, which is like you know, it's one of the first new pieces of art coming out of the latest expansion. So exciting. And yeah, I was just talking with Darek last night about my painting process, and I realized that he and I work very, very differently. So I wanted to share a little bit of how I work, because I think that you know, if you're a fan of Level Up, that I'll probably be doing something pretty different than what you've seen in the past. So we should probably pull up a screen. I'm going to see if I can share my screen here. Do a screen share.
Yeah, Darek, can you switch the screen to Peter?
Yeah, sure.
You just have to switch it on the.
Yeah, it's set on his screen right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, but you are sharing your, like, I can see.
I got my
screen. Yeah, it's all right right now, I guess.
Okay. If you click on my thumbnail, I think.
Peter, can I just switch to my screen once again, because I would like to introduce some of your works on different art, so people can see it. I am pretty sure that they are know your stuff, but. Be aware that it's amazing stuff made by Peter. Pictures are on Peter Mohrbacher DeviantArt.com. You can just go and try to look at all this magic stuff he is doing right now. I've seen his process of painting, and it's amazing. So you can go to his gallery, follow him, and check his amazing stuff. So we are pretty happy to have you on board today, man. So, yeah, let's just start some talk about your process, maybe.
Okay. Yeah. Do you click on my thumbnail there? Okay. So yes. Cool. We're on my screen now. So this is a raw scan of a sketch that I did in an airport a while back. I've been meaning to get back to it. This is sort of my wheelhouse, is these sort of humanoid guys with a little bit of a surreal touch, a little bit of surface.
Like your angels you are painting, right?
Yeah, it was a lot like the angels, and then I've kind of got this, it's expanded outside the angels, of just sort of mixing this humanoid anatomy with this more, you know, raw shape design.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, it's the same kind of mental process that you do when you're making armor or whatever, but I really like painting organic shapes, and what I found was a lot of fun was to sort of integrate some of this abstract organic design with the humanoid form, and I was going to do a little bit of a layout of a painting just to give an example of how I work. So this is the raw scan. I usually just double click to unlock it. I know some people copy it.
So how big your sketch is usually? Like it's like from a sketchbook or?
Yeah, it's from a sketchbook. I can hold it up on the camera actually.
So you have, like, are you a sketchy guy? Like, do you like to sketch?
Yeah.
Or yeah, you do.
No, This is my sketchbook, and typically what I'm doing are a lot of thumbnails and stuff, and I gotta be careful because there's a lot of magic stuff that's under NDA in here.
So
let me pull up that screen share again. So I actually don't have a ton of sketches. I tend to invest really heavily in a small number of pieces rather mm-hmm. than do a lot of really quick paintings or do a lot of drawings. I need to up the number.
Oh.
Oh, snap. Hangout, here we go again.
Yeah.
Let's just get him back, Peter.
Peter, how are you?
Oh, shit. I have no idea what is happening. I hope he knows. Damn it, every fucking session, man.
Yeah, man.
Every fucking session.
So maybe, Wojtek, let's pick up some paintings to the
overpaintings. Shit, no, this is too much freaking... I was hyped for it, man. We just have to bring him back. Let's try Facebook or just... We cannot call him. Or just Skype him, you know?
Yeah, I Skyped him and I'm trying to...
But call him, you know?
Okay.
Oh, shit. Emergency. Sorry, guys. Again, our... Oh, snap. Yeah.
Okay.
You know, sometimes Hangout is just randomly dropping out people. We just couldn't figure out why. So whenever it happens, just rejoin the link and okay. It will be all good.
Yes.
So this is just a cleanup. And the reason I want to get it to white is because instead of setting things to multiply, I've got a tutorial for this online. I actually use a procedural process for deleting out the white of the drawing. And just like that, I'm able to go and have the pixels get deleted dynamically based off of their value. So the white pixels are getting deleted 100% while the black pixels are getting deleted none. And check out my YouTube channel if you want to see a complete explanation of it, because it's kind of tedious to go over in a stream like this.
Mm-hmm.
But typically when I'm working sort of when I'm trying to do a good job with my process and I'm trying to be diligent and not rush on a picture, I lay down a pretty, even though the sketch is loose, I try to get a silhouette locked in at 100% underneath the sketch. That way I'm able to, if I want to erase out the base sketch, I can paint in behind the figure very easily. Mm-hmm. And I can use the eraser tool with a hard edge to cut out any hard edges I want on the silhouette. I tend to work with pretty hard edges around my figures, so this is a process that works really well for me to do that.
So you tend to figure out all the designs on the stage of sketching, and then you are just going in and locking the silhouette in a Photoshop, right? Or just are you leaving some room for you to play around later on in Photoshop, like with painting, or how does it work for you?
Typically, I do make some pretty dramatic changes, but the goal is to always make fewer and fewer changes going forwards. Like, clearly, I haven't worked out the whole narrative of this piece, and there's areas of it that are underworked or completely need to be changed, and I'll be able to change those in Photoshop. But
mm-hmm.
If I can do really well with my process, and this is just a sketch, I could make a very clean sketch and then make very few changes. The ideal is the fewest number of changes late as possible.
Mm-hmm.
So I really want to encourage myself to make a process that each step. I trust the work that's being done in that step, and I move forward confidently so that I don't have to constantly reinvent the painting every single time that I throughout the entire time I'm working on it. I want to be able to trust creatively.
Yeah, it's also less frightening, right? If you know exactly where you are heading, like if it's a commission or you're working under like some deadline, it's super important to keep yourself reassured that you are going into the right direction. You are not like researching all the time, scrapping around.
Yeah, and especially, yes, you're right, especially for commissions. When I'm working on a magic card, I have to do it to a brief, and I want to solve what I'm doing with that piece very early in the process and not have to mess around with it because... Mm-hmm.
And just execute, right?
Yeah, I need to execute on it because I need, at the end of the day, I need to have a finished painting. Mm-hmm. So I've got, you know, most of the figure that I know is going to be there blocked out pretty strong, so I can do some really loose stuff behind it. And if I just want to go... I don't have a lot of really shapy brushes. I usually use the round brush for a lot of stuff, but for, like, loose blocking, I've got my Jamie Jones brush set. I've picked out a couple of them on my... And this is my whole tool panel over here.
Mm-hmm.
With just a few custom brushes, and most of it just being done with a round brush.
So first, black and white. Just
yes.
Basically.
Yes, I always start like this nowadays. I used to start in color, but like once I started working professionally, that went away really quickly because again the predictability started to really really matter.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was going straight into color, I would have to redo. If I didn't like where I started with things. I had to redo all the rendering in addition to the color in order to make changes. So
yeah, that's right.
I really needed to have the color as a separate step, and I'm going to go into that right away. I'm just rushing through this. So, you know, I'm blocking these out separately so I can kind of adjust them separately. I want to be working darks to lights for the most part, so I'm going to be blocking my silhouette in darker than I really need it. But then... to colorize it, my first step is usually to try to establish a palette using a gradient map.
Mm-hmm.
And setting that to a soft light. But really, before then, I have something saved here, just like on those cooking shows. I've got a snapshot with some values already blocked in.
Mm-hmm.
So this was a value block in that I had done last night while I was talking to Dark. And, you know, I've got my gradient map laid in. I've set it to soft light. I'm getting a little bit of this green to purple palette.
Dark, can you lock the screen on Peter? Because I don't think you did that and it's switching.
Yes, it's locked all the time.
Oh. It might be locked, but I think our visualization of it as guests on the stream is different.
We don't see our screen right now.
Yeah. All right. Sorry. Go ahead.
So above that, I typically do a hard light layer, and the hard light is cool because it allows me to be thinking in one of two ways. I can either think about it in terms of the color of the light that's hitting the form. Like if I want a warm light hitting certain parts of the form, I can start to paint in a warm color, and it'll act almost like a warm light hitting the surface, like I'm illuminating it.
Mm-hmm.
But what it also does, which is one of my favorite things, is that you can think about it also as a local color. So if I want an element to be red, all I need to do is lay in red right on top of it, and it will... push the values sort of into the gamut of that color. So if I take just this warm middle color and I start hitting over these dark spots, instead of like a color layer, which is going to go all muddy and weird, you can mm-hmm. see now I've got this orange, this saturated orange is starting to appear rather than, you know, the real value of the color, which is somewhere down here, and it's going to make this really muddy result. So by mushing that around, I'm able to get like a sense of light and color inside the piece, and I'm able to get all sorts of awesome, unexpected colors. As I'm going over these blacks, you can see I'm getting all this
warms,
yeah, and I'm getting these colorful shadows, and I'm getting these dynamic, saturated middle tones. And the more I go back and forth over this, the more I'm starting to really establish a full dynamic palette.
Yeah, and it also looks very like traditional oil, like the palette is very very Zorny like, you know.
Yeah, I like to use a limited number of colors in my palette to start off with, because I feel like trying to pick out very precise local colors for everything and have each of them affected by in different ways by different colored lights, it comes up with this very digital look. I really like the look of limited palette paintings, and this is common in genre paintings, like in old fantasy paintings that you see for like role-playing games and stuff. They often were using like really isolated colors, and I think it gives it a really cool look. So, this is where I'm establishing my colors, and it's totally separate from the value process. Because if I'm doing this really diligently, what I'm going to do is get a really strong value structure first, and I'm going to I ended up using a soft light on this one, but probably normal to like paint in stronger and get those values really clear. And then once they're clear, these layers are going to do a lot better work. The one builds on top of the other really dynamically. So I found at some point after using this process and sometimes getting really good results and sometimes getting horrible failure results, that the difference was really how much of the value I'd worked out. And when I was skipping ahead too fast, mm-hmm. and when I was not paying attention to doing good values, the colorization process revealed those mistakes right away. And I didn't even realize that's what was happening. I thought, so sometimes I know how to color and sometimes I don't. But really it was the process sort of speaking back to me and letting me know that I was jumping the gun. And you know, the more powerful this step seems, is an indicator of how effective I've been at this step in the process.
Yeah, so you are not messing up your value structure while you're working out the colors. You can always do another like hard light layer and gradient map layer over the top, or group or in mm-hmm. another groups, and even provide different color variations for a client if it's commission work, right?
Oh yeah, and so like if I do this and I'm like, oh, this isn't what I wanted at all, I really want a cool light setup, I just turn those layers off and I start going back in. And sometimes I'll use selective color instead of gradient map, depending on the circumstances. I think selective color is really good for certain things. One of my favorite things about gradient map is how broken some of these things look. Like, if you get something like this and it's, you get these totally nutso results mm-hmm. With these you know, these gradients that were never intended for this purpose, you start getting some, it starts sometimes giving ideas for the piece. And, you know, I'll try to figure out how to ease it a little bit. Is it updating?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Because I'm seeing, like, I'm seeing like someone else's screen. It's, like, from, like, 5 minutes ago.
So, Peter... You have pretty nice division of the layers, and you keep it pretty clean and intuitive for yourself to not mess up with layers. And you start with gradient map, which is just as one color or just some switch with gradients. But hard light can help you to get a lot of variations, like oil painting. And you told me yesterday it's the way to keep your paintings pretty oily alike.
Yeah, the biggest step though, and like this is just setup. This is like me trying to do when you're oil painting, you want to do color studies, you want to do value studies, you want to like mm-hmm. build up your process, because you really only get one shot at rendering this thing, and you can't just start slapping paint down. I mean, you can, but you don't know where you're going. So for commercial mm-hmm. work, you need to have this process, and these layers really stand in for that step. But then once I feel like I understand where the piece is going and I have a clear vision on the type of palette, mm-hmm. I've got these golds and these you know, the bluish grays, and it's this limited scheme, and it's this kind of extreme value structure and lighting that is, you know, kind of is working for me. I just go on top of it with a normal layer, mm-hmm. and I take my round brush that's set to size flow. Before, I would just use this one, which is just like, it'd have all these circles and everything, and I'd have to go back in and I'd render the heck out of them, just to like, you know, push it all out. But nowadays, I've got this brush I stole from Jamie Jones, size flow, and it's got this, with the flow turned down, it gets these nice expressive edges to it, where when you run, you know, lengthwise against something, you get these very hard edges, but then it feathers once you change directions and things, and that gives it a very more painterly look. So I just go in here and I zoom in really close, and I just start like noodling with it, and I start picking at it and pushing the resulting colors around. And if I do really well with my drawing and really well with my values and really well with my palette and my color picking, I can just finish a piece on a normal layer. I don't think it's ever happened like that. But that's the ideal that I'm pushing towards, is to have a to get to this point and then just be able to like build in subtlety.
Just render it out, right?
Yeah, work on my edges. Just think a lot about the edges and about the rendering and like
polishing,
consistency. Yeah, and just like scumbling and licking it and just getting the whole thing painted out the way I want, all with just a very simple brush. Mm-hmm. And since it's on a separate layer, I can always test it against the layers underneath to see whether or not the work I'm doing is worth keeping. If I change too many things, I'll wipe it out and go back to the layer underneath and just start.
So I have a question about like control it color palette. I encountered that topic in Gurney's book, Color and Light. He was very, very specific in like defining how to do it, or imaginative realism. I don't remember exactly, but can you just tell a little bit more about it? How do you choose which palette will work? How do you like cut it out from a color wheel, as I saw you doing? So how does it
work?
Oh,
yeah. I'm going to open up my color wheel here. I have everything in Dropbox. Everything I do is in Dropbox. So I've got my color wheel, and let's pull this out and look at how it is in comparison to this. So we've got our, our bright yellow. We think about this as terms of, if I wanted to paint this as an oil painting, what pigments would I need in order to complete this painting? I would obviously need some very bright yellow, and I would need some of these saturated oranges. And then it kind of goes into this pale blue. And so this is a wedge. If you pick which pigments you're going to choose, and in oil painting, it's just what tubes of paint you choose. It's an arbitrary restriction. You get what's ever in that triangle or hexagon between them. If you choose every one of these colors, you can theoretically mix the whole wheel. But what Gurney talks about is you pick like this color, and this one, and this is what you get. This is your whole palette. Every color in the world is now part of this. And if you want any kind of greens or blues, they just get crushed into the gray. And the perception of the world, the perception of all the color in that little world you're making, gets crushed down into this limited palette. And the results are very artistic, and they tend to be very interesting.
Yeah, that's right. That's also what I found about limited palette. I was really surprised when I was painting in oils how much you can really achieve even with three pigments, right? It was just crazy that you could even suggest greens using just, for example, I don't know, yellow ochre or it works like a complementary color kind of suggestion, and it just crossed my, you know, digital kind of thinking that I had, and it's kind of a blessing to be a little bit more controlled before you really commit to, because, you know, you are opening Photoshop and you have like freaking all the freaking colors you can use, and that's what really creates that digital effect on most of the people's work. it's just that they are just crushing, color dodging, linear dodging,
overlaying.
Yeah.
But you know, I discovered the once I started trying to paint in oils just even a little bit, just like a few days of poking around with it, all those lessons that I had heard from James Gurney, read in the books, like I went from sort of feeling like I understood them to really knowing them, and it only happened after I was really proposed, after I was really limited by the real materials.
Yeah, that's
true.
I really
recommend anybody who wants to learn more about this, they need to get out there and just get a cheap painting set, oils or acrylics, and just start mixing colors on a palette, because it'll open your eyes to what you're really doing digitally. And what's funny is that I was actually doing this beforehand. This was an older piece of mine where I'd used a limited palette just by trying to crush the color, these more realistic colors out of it using gradient maps, and by using really unpredictable gradient maps, mm-hmm. I ended up with this red-blue color scheme where the reds took the places of blacks and spots, and mm-hmm. I was able to create this sort of surreal color space. And then I've been looking back on it now, trying to figure out, okay, if I wanted to do this in pigments, what colors would I be using? What is this really doing? Cutting out sections of a color wheel to figure out, like, if I wanted to do this in a different palette, what would I really need in terms of pigments if I wanted to reproduce this effect? And I've been learning everything backwards, because learning as a digital artist, you skip over these super, super important points.
That's true.
That never come up until you go back and check them out. I got lucky and started working before I learned all this stuff, but I've always felt like an amateur even while I was working, and I feel so much more confident in my work now that I've started to learn the real fundamentals of it, and I feel like my work is more controlled and more predictable, and I have more fun with it now that I know what the real rules are that have been governing the tools that I've been using this entire time.
So you have started from digital.
Oh, yeah.
So you're pure digital. So how long have you been painting, like, first?
Let's see. It's about Photoshop version 4.
Oh, shit.
Whoa.
I started it in high school, just poking around with a mouse.
Uh-huh.
Most back before you. A lot of the online communities that are around were there, I was looking at, when I started to really paint was, I think, 2004,
mm-hmm.
so about 10 years ago. CG Talk was the big stuff back then. I was posting work to CG Talk,
mm-hmm.
Back before it became CG Society. And
How come your work looks so traditional, even though you have started like purely digital? Is it your like inspirations you are looking up to, or you tried oils, or you are just feeding yourself with a knowledge from just master paintings? How does it work?
This is the interesting part, and this is blind luck. I'm a very, very lucky person. I don't know anything about classical art. I didn't study any classical artists until long after I learned how to paint. I never worked in oils or acrylics before I worked in digital. The reason why is because I was looking at paintings that I loved at the time where I was learning how to paint, and I was looking at products that I liked, and I was trying to figure out, just by looking at the marks, what tools are those artists using?
Uh-huh.
And one of the artists that I tried to emulate around the time when I started painting was, I should know his name, did a bunch of character art for Capcom. Mm-hmm. And I remember looking at a Capcom art book at a Japanese grocery store and, like, mm-hmm. looking at these brushy marks that were on the page, and I was trying to figure out what Photoshop brush makes that mark. And in Photoshop version 5, there wasn't the brush panel. They didn't have this. They had two buttons. They had size and they had opacity. And you could either have one or the other or both, and that was it. So I was like, it's clearly not opacity, it's got to be size. So I started learning to paint just self-taught, just with a size flow brush, just this. And I had turned the opacity down, and at some point I turned the flow down. I think it was just like this at first.
Uh-huh.
And this was it. And I bought a cheap off-brand tablet, and I would just, you know, poke at it. And when I learned that the Alt key turned on the eyedropper tool, I would just do this. Mm-hmm. And that was where it all came from, mm-hmm. was just the process of, like, trying to make all my marks and do all my rendering just by sampling with the Alt key.
Uh-huh.
And I don't even know if I learned that from a tutorial or if I learned it by accident or what. But I was switching back and forth between the brush and the eyedropper, but then I like learned the Alt key, and then it was game over, and I could just render just with the size brush.
Yeah.
And that was it. I could get crisp edges. I could do smooth transitions as long as I pushed at it long enough. And it was the fact that that tool made that chunkiness automatically, just by the nature of the way I moved my hand would control the look of it. That made an oil painting look, and it was purely by accident, and I've learned everything I know about oil painting since then, and it was a really, really good accident to happen because, you know, I just got stuck that way, and I still use, like, now I've got this one with the textured edge, but I didn't even start using that until this year,
mm-hmm.
and pretty much all my work has just been me figuring out how to get colors and down and values down, and then just getting in close and just start working on edges and rendering.
So while we are talking about techniques, are you like, because we are just talking right now about like your one technique, right, that you were developing over the years to make the best product possible for your client in probably the shortest amount of time. So that's the technique for that you have developed that depicts your personality, and but do you like to explore different techniques? Are you that guy that likes to, you know, to dive in into some different stuff, or you prefer to make your technique better and better, or you try to dive into some new stuff sometimes? How does it work for you? Are you looking in traditional or and digital for like new experiences, or you just don't because you have one like amazing technique? How does it work for you?
Learning's uncomfortable for me. Like I love learning, but at the same time, and trying to like break out of old habits is always so hard that I don't really look for them. But every once in a while, I'll see something and I'll be like, I need to know how to do that. Or something will just blow across my path. Like, I had a friend who was showing me this photo adjusting technique, and he showed me that you could do this dynamic selection. This is Control Alt 2, and this is a RGB selection. You get it off of the channels if you control click the RGB channel. And then he showed me if you do a copy merge and then paste it down, you end up with this really weird layer that can then be remultiplied to push your midtones down without darkening your blacks, without touching your whites.
Instead of doing levels that are just moving all stuff around.
It was a photo adjustment technique, and I tried it out on some of my paintings, and I went like, oh man, they get this kind of like, you get this kind of rich look. Like
rich, richest.
Washed out to like, getting this kind of like, rich, saturated look to it, and you can. I was like, what if I overlay it? And then it starts giving this big, blown out look.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, so there's some interesting stuff going on here, and then I can take a normal layer and put some white over it. And then when I realized what I was doing, I realized that that selection could actually be used to delete the white out of a drawing. And that's how I developed my, like, deleting the white technique, was based off of sort of adapting the knowledge from a photo adjustment technique. And, you know, it just, I don't really like looking for this stuff. I just like my habits, and but when something comes along, it all builds together, and I've over the course of 10 years started to build a library of these sorts of things.
So how long it takes you to finish the one piece, for example, for magic card, or but you mentioned that you are trying to make a bit more loosey and speed painting alike. Last time pictures you told me yesterday. So how long it takes you to get the finished one, and it's just just up to the number of characters, or just composition, or perspective. Can you explain to us something?
It's usually about 20 hours.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not very fast. And some people say I'm very fast, and sometimes I feel like the slowest artist in the world because, I see speed paintings and I can't speed paint. I don't know how. Mm-hmm. I know how to render, and I know how to work through a painting one step at a time, and that I can get a good painting as long as it's got fewer elements done in about 10 hours. Mm-hmm. But most of the time, I'm looking at about 20 hours.
Mm-hmm. So like that's
10 more hours of fucking around with it.
So that's the goal you are establishing before you finish the one, and you just establish, okay, this is the 20 hours picture, and I have to be in that time, sometimes more flexible.
If I'm at 20 hours and it's half finished, that means it's going to take 40 hours to finish. Like, mm-hmm. my thought on time is that me. Whenever I'm working on a painting, I'm just going to spend as much time as it takes to finish mm-hmm. the painting. Mm-hmm. That was actually what got me from having a lots of like little doodles to having finished paintings, was to decide that I was going to spend literally any amount of time mm-hmm. as long as I got the look that I wanted in the end. Mm-hmm. And this meant if I wanted a cracked leather coat, I needed to paint in every crack and bump, every shadow and highlight of every crack and bump manually mm-hmm. with a circle brush. And if it took me 100 hours, that's how long it took me. Mm-hmm. And it was only after deciding that I started getting portfolio work and start getting published and start mm-hmm. moving forward with my career. So I've kept that philosophy the whole time, that I don't put any kind of, I don't track the time I'm working, and I don't put deadlines on myself. Mm-hmm. I just, I put deadlines on finishing a painting, but I don't tell myself how long it needs to take. Mm-hmm. I just make sure, I know about how long a painting of a certain type takes, and I make sure to block out that time, and I try to get good habits about starting stuff well before it's due, and working on things regardless mm-hmm. of the deadline, and sometimes I end up finishing stuff way early, and mm-hmm. that's always really great when that happens. It's not common, but and then sometimes I'm up against the deadline and I'm turning in stuff I'm not happy with.
Mm-hmm.
But that's the nature of commercial work.
So you are kind of person who makes something in the one long session and finish it in few days, or you just make 2 hours per day, or you have any schedule for that, or it depends on your mood.
It depends on my mood. It depends on availability. But there is a piece that I worked on for 3 years, and I wonder if I could find. I think I can find it.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a. It was like I kept getting feeling like I was just about finished with it, and then I'd get back to it after a week and go, no, I don't want to do this.
Mm-hmm.
Here it is, this painting. So, let's see. Lilio 11. Every time I would do a major reboot of the painting, I would add one iteration. I don't change it. So this took me 3 years to make.
Oh, that's great,
like,
fun.
Like, one character and a simple background. but, like...
It looks awesome, totally awesome.
Yeah.
But, like, this is the original.
Oh, man.
yeah. And I got 3 years better in the time. Like, the poses, I was like, I'd get up to a point, I would be rendering out this cloth, mm-hmm. and I'd go, okay, I think that looks good, but I need to work out this hand. Or, there's something about the wing design I don't like. And every single time I would reboot it.
For
and it was like,
3 years.
Yeah, for 3 years until I said, this is for a personal piece, I want to be happy with it. Like, so here's iteration 5. You know? And at some point I say, okay, I'm almost done with this. I just need to render this, render that. And then I think about it, I'm like, oh, I'm not happy. And then, you know, iteration 8. Change the leg to figure out this, you know. Winked. I've done all this rendering. I've done so much rendering. Like, each one of these is a mark. Like, nothing's done automatically. Like, it's me making lots of individual marks. And I think I tried using a brush to speed things up, but I didn't like the look in the end. Mm-hmm. And it's just lots of circle brush. There's a little bit of photo texture in the background to get the nebula going. Mm-hmm. Scatter brush photo for the moon, which I think I just painted the whole thing over from scratch at some point. Version 10, you know, it's like things are, and then like version 11, I think I broke the wings off the back.
Yeah, put them on the hip. Definitely.
And it looks a little bit more balanced right now.
Yeah, the big problem with this piece was how unbalanced it was. And I thought I was going to have the wings going one way, and then I was going to have the cloth going the other way. That there was going to be sweeping this cloth over. But I can never get it the way I want it to.
Can you zoom in a bit?
Yeah.
So, oh, just wait, no. This
enjoy 3 years of painting, you know.
Low res.
Celebrate it.
But then it finally, I think that's the thing that busted it open, was changing the balance of the piece to have it have this cross shape rather than more of a cross-shaped energy than to have, like, these big wings flowing off in one direction.
Uh-huh.
So you could see, like, this... It's repainting these same elements over and over again. Yeah. And I think there's some of that crappy custom brush is still in there, painted over with my mushy circle brush for the final pass. But any kind of texture in here, this is all just me circle brush, like, picking at it.
Yeah. Trying to make it look so patient. You know, you are a total opposite of me. You know, I'm just rushing things so much, and this is why it is just so refreshing to talk to you right now and to look at your process, because I just make myself, like, rush all the freaking time, and I'm just jumping around, and, you know, I'm just that kind of person that needs more restrictions, and... Yeah. As I look at your workflow, it's just amazing to look how rules can make you do a better work, and that's amazing, really.
Thank you. this is an older piece. I want to just zoom in on one of my newer ones. Like, I'm looking at this, and I'm seeing. Let me get some of these older versions out of the way.
Yeah, I totally love that piece. Wasn't it popular on CG Hub or something?
I got a front page on CG Hub, yeah.
Oh, shit, yeah. That's, like, the first piece.
So this annoys the shit out of me when I go and see this on older paintings, is these concentric circles from the brush I was using. And I've gotten really lazy on some of these edges, like, around this face. Like, this is too mushy for this chin. This transition from the cloth to the face. This is ugly. I do not like this. Rendering through here could be a lot more intentional. I've got these edges that get weaker when they shouldn't. There's these shapes that are, like, are not conforming to the content of the interior, the silhouette. So looking back on this now, even though this is a very detailed painting and it looks crisp at a distance, I am not happy with it. So nowadays, when you look in closer at my paintings, you can see I'm using a different brush, so I don't get those concentric circles quite as much, but I'm still doing a lot of the same things. You can see the texture of the brush is I'm letting some of the edges get a little looser, but the overall brushwork has gotten cleaner over time. But it's a lot of the same stuff. You know, I paint in, all the textures are all painted in, round brush, small strokes, using reference to figure out what I want as far as the materials go. In this case, this is a kind of texture that I'm very familiar with. It's very painty and clay-like, and I knew I just wanted to make something that was mushy and like a big blob of paint. So I didn't need to really, I've been doing this for 10 years, I don't need to use reference for that much, but lots of reference on the face, multiple mm-hmm. different types of reference, stuff I shot, stuff I pulled off the internet, things that I've traced, there's changes, there's, you know, reference for the hair is different than reference for the face, different for the lighting, mm-hmm. it's like...
So you don't, like, do as photo shoot to make your reference as close as possible to your painting, you're just looking for different sources and just doing
yeah.
like a, yeah.
In yeah. some cases, like you can see, I shot my hand here for the monster's hand, and I didn't end up even shooting for lighting. The lighting is different. I was just shooting mm-hmm. for structure, and I've exaggerated the shapes, but I wanted to know, you know, what do you need to describe that kind of grip? I've got stuff for texture that I've pulled off the internet. I found a model that I wanted to use for the figure, uh-huh. and I've traced the face from one of the shots to be able to make sure the anatomy is right on, because I'm very bad about the copying from photos indirectly. Uh-huh. So once it's all incorporated into the painting, I don't feel that bad about using some of the facial contours to establish the drawing, especially if I can peel back some layers here, you can see the drawing wasn't that good. I was able to get the palette pretty early mm-hmm. using the method I described, but like the drawing for the girl's face was pretty bad and uninteresting, and it was once I traced over that photo that I was able to get the
exact look you wanted.
The kind of face that I really wanted for this piece. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, my preconception about how the hair was going to work was totally wrong. Mm-hmm. As I looked, trolled Facebook and Google image search for girls with punky haircuts, I was able to find something that was more believable to be able to pull together.
Yeah, sometimes I find myself like laughing at myself, like, all of my misconceptions about things I get, like I paint in my paintings that I think something looks like, and then I confront it with reality, and I'm like fucking 14.
You
know?
Yeah.
Just
people, they get so nervous about being art thieves, and that they uh-huh. don't want to really compare their work against reality because they're worried that reality is going to infect their work. But
yeah.
you need to have reality infected in your work. You need to have that reference. You need to.
It has to be believable, right?
Yeah, and like there's a before I even drew this painting, let me see if I can find the folder. I had to put together a little bit of a reference folder for it. Working. Let's see. I need to find where I put it all. Oh, personal ref. Yes. So I had found I don't know a lot about women's fashion, so I had to I wanted a girl in a simple black dress, so I had mm-hmm. to go and dig around the internet for it, and I had to like pick the style of dress that I wanted, and I used it sort of indirectly. I got photo mm-hmm. some photo shots. I had a lot of them. General mood pieces that I had pulled off of fashion editorials that I liked quite a bit, and you can see there's definitely a similarity in the mood here, of the, you know, this sort of looking at girl looking off in the distance and this monster face behind her.
Peter, you started the gathering the materials before you sketch out the thing, or sketch out the thing and trying to fit the design and all the stuff, finding. After that you made a sketch, or how it worked for this piece especially.
In this piece, I knew I wanted a character. I wanted to make a piece where there was a girl whose fears were on the outside of her body. That was the concept. Mm-hmm. I had an idea. I had a concept, and mm-hmm. I wanted to have this character who was fearless. And I wanted her to be this kind of punky chick with this retro vintage look to her.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted her to be all in black. And that's stuff that I all knew. Like, that was before I sketched, before I looked for any photos. I had an idea I wanted to express. I had a mood I knew I wanted, and I found I dug through my reference to find editorial work that matched that mood and matched that subject matter. I did research on the type of clothing that I wanted to show. I didn't bother researching the monster because I knew it was going to be a monster design that was like other things I had done in the past.
So you are enriching your design and your ideas while working. It's kind of, you know, just not fitting exactly what have you started, but it's about enriching your ideas, your concept.
And I had started looking at Jeffrey Jones's work for the paintier bits, and you can see there's a definite similarity in the way I'd done the clouds to some Jeffrey Jones pieces.
Structures.
So I had, you know, throughout the process, I was also, this is when I started to look at other artists to look for solutions to the color palette and the rendering style and things like that. You know, once that became the point where I was at with the painting, I found a lot of photos of this one model. I found one photo I liked. I was digging through a big pile of models, and I found a photo I liked of a girl with a face I really liked. I reverse image searched it to get her name, and then I found a bunch of other shoots with her so that I could get a lot of comparative reference.
So you don't hesitate to just, you know, go farther with the piece without rechanging. If you think that something is not like you imagined or enjoy yourself, you just quietly remove and repaint it. So the same with the face of this girl. It looks pretty awesome right now. I think you were good job with that. And, you know, it was aware of yourself that, okay, something is not that much what I wanted, so I will refine it again. So, it's great that you are, you know, going exactly that enjoys yourself, not only, okay, I finish it and I start a new one. You have to make it pretty, you know, finalized the way you are pretty happy with that.
Yeah, this was I think the earliest rough. I'd gotten some feedback from someone I trusted, and they said, you know, you need to tilt the camera, you need to expand the canvas because this crop was too tight. And her feedback pushed this piece forward substantially. Like the amount of additional energy and interest that I got as a result of making that change was huge. That was something I made early in the process. You know, being taking good advice and you're right, is a lot of self-editing. When I do something and I know this isn't what I want, this isn't going in the right direction, I didn't use the right reference, it's not got the right feeling, I make sure to go back and just redo it because every little thing that I find myself do wrong that bothers me, if I let it slide, it's going to bother someone else too. And
yeah,
I'm
great.
Losing by denying the fact that I didn't get it right the first time. Like, I got a lot in this picture really early that was what I wanted to do. There was so little fussing with getting the color palette right. It just came out, like, in a minute. And then that stuck through the whole time. Like, almost nothing changed about that palette. And I got that in 30 seconds. And but everything else took so much fussing to get it where I wanted it and to get everything I wanted about it. Yeah, this all this stuff down here, this is all circle brush. This is...
Man, you are crazy.
It's not that hard. It really isn't. You listen to a podcast or there's people probably painting right now. If you want to, like, just... If you can learn how to paint clouds or rocks or wood or hair or cloth or any of these abstract materials and learn how to do it without using any photo overlays or textures or anything, just do it all with a circle brush or like with a pencil or with a paintbrush, the more of those materials you learn, the more richly you can detail your work without having to rely on automatic tools that you don't have control of.
So it makes you also, you know, pretty special. I don't know much with people in digital art industry that works only with one brush. We talked about it yesterday. You told me that for almost 10 years you've been working only round brush with hard edges and soft edges. It was mind blowing for myself.
I don't even use a soft brush because if I want to get a soft blend, I mean, you can see I'm getting it.
Mm-hmm.
It's fine. I just turn the opacity down and I just, you know.
Yeah, and just make a blend.
So what do you say when people ask you, what brush that be? Or, you know, what brush is your question?
Brush from Photoshop 5.
Yeah.
You know, Round Brush Pro?
Yeah. And but the thing is, here's what I learned. It's really good for, the Round Brush, really good for organic stuff, and I was about to open up this other painting I started working on. It sucks for landscapes. It super sucks for landscapes. Because there's so many more additional elements in a landscape painting. So I find that I'm trying to learn how to use brushes better for, like, landscape work, which is...
It's your new work?
What's that?
It's your new work?
Yeah, this is a sketch that I've been working up recently. I just was poking at this the other day. I had a pile of thumbnails left over from me working with someone on their landscape art. But I was like, oh, I should learn how to do this. So I blew up my thumbnail, and I went through the same colorization process that I just demoed. And then I started going in with normal layers and a little bit of hard light.
Man, don't be kidding. It's pretty cool.
I think landscape painting uses a lot of the same artistic tools, the same sense of balance and motion and repetition that I've learned doing figure painting. But there's just so many more little rocks that you need to paint, so I've been trying to expand my brush palette just a little bit to do better environment painting. I think it depends on what kind of painting you want to make. I could do the whole thing with round brush. I'd probably do better with like a square, something flat, so I can get like more flat terminals.
You can still use a lot of lasso to just block your shapes, making scary ones and filling it with your regular round brush. So I think it's pretty good because when you are working on that landscape, it's just, you know, fill the solids on the elements. You can just fill the solid on every rock, even if it's not, you know, the tile, because it takes a lot of time to get the roundy brushes the effect you want. It still has the mass. It's not like, you know, just putting the texture brush, which a lot of people use, and it has, you know, more solid and more fundamental things. I think it's you know, just good ones. So I don't think so that the texture ones and using another brush it's also that good.
I've been playing around with the 3D brushes a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the trying to use them because they make a more dynamic mark.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I don't know yet. They're a little bit hard to control, which I guess is fine if they're. I don't need to worry about anatomy, but mm-hmm. Yeah, I was telling you, I don't ever use the lasso for anything. Like, mm-hmm. I think I probably
should start. It's great to block in the shapes and making overpaints environments pretty fast. So only just compositions and blocking the shapes. The other process is the same like you said. So
yeah. So yeah, we should get to some overpainting because that's pretty much all I have to say on this stuff.
Yeah.
That's been an hour's worth of me fast talking my way through, like,
yeah. So maybe can you pick up the picture and make a first overpaint?
Let's see if this, just in case. Yeah, sure. Let's see if I can find. I've got level up here. Thanks to everyone who's sending me Facebook invites. I love this because I didn't know how to find more people on Facebook. So, is there anyone in the chat that I know is here? Can we make sure that the person's here?
I'm checking.
And Pete, the demo you did was just awesome, so thank you for that.
Yeah.
I think everybody enjoyed it as much as I did.
Exactly.
I got questions to repeat some of the stuff.
So you can just
video tutorial out of my coloring process, so don't worry about it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But if there's anyone who's in the
regarding
chat
overpaint,
who has,
we don't have a time maybe to just check, pick up the one you like to overpaint and. Yeah, we go farther with that because for our rating.
Okay, let's see.
But don't be rushed, man. Don't be rushed. Have your time.
I don't know which one makes sense. I want to find something that I have something productive to say about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Okay.
So I don't know. Oh, here's someone who I'm working with.
Mm-hmm.
He's getting plenty of feedback from me. which ones do you like? I don't know how to pick.
It's up to you, man.
God, I keep saying that. I'm so bad at nitpicking people's art. I am very critical of my own stuff, but whenever I work with someone, I'm always like, okay, let's start a new piece. Let's work through all the ideas. You know, it's all about, I feel like so many pieces miss on their communication,
mm-hmm.
much more than their execution. Like, a lot of the shortcomings of portfolio work I see out of aspiring artists, the weakest part has to do with
mm-hmm.
what are they trying to say with it? You know, what's the idea behind it? And, you know, the technical stuff, it's like you can let a lot of technical stuff slide if the concept is really, really good.
Mm-hmm.
I'm living proof of that. I mean, I didn't know how to do anything as far as painting goes for so long, but I was able to BS my way through it because I figured out how to make metaphors using my paintings, like, really, really early by accident. There's a lot of work on here. You guys have this totally active community.
Yeah, that's crazy. That's why we are doing, like, we are planning to do more sessions.
Yes.
And, you know, you can just pick whatever you really like. I think maybe some recent ones because it's
the more fresh.
Through some stuff.
Okay, maybe that one, Peter.
This one? Yeah, okay. Let's look at this one. This is Witcher 2, so we got a little Polish action going on. Oh, can't drag and drop out of DeviantArt. Hate that. So this person has started to get to a lot of rendering already. They're building up black and white first. This is well beyond the point where I would have started jumping into color personally, but there are some issues with it that I would probably address before moving forward with it. Because I'm really looking at it up here in the Navigator. This is where I critique a lot of my own work. Is, you know, I get really picky about the edges up close when I'm in the rendering process. But when I'm thinking about how finished a piece is, so much of it comes from what I see in the thumbnail. And the big problems I've seen, of course, are like, oh, this guy in the foreground is like. He's got this full dynamic range of value all the way from like these deep, deep blacks and these super bright whites, and they're like right next to each other. And I'm just not crazy about that. Like, if we were to just have this guy as his own star of his own show, as his own picture, he's like so gross and like not in a way that's fascinating. Like, these beads on his back, like, are so much less interesting than the real musculature of a back, you know? And these, like, these folds, all these, like, kind of gross, fatty, skinny folds, they're, like, they're not the kind of interesting morphology that you see out of monsters or people, and I don't, it's, like, it's just gross to look at, and Not like, I don't know where the fantasy comes from that makes me want to look at someone's like gross and misshapen back. Like, I want to see something that's like, if it's a monster, it I feel like it should be intimidating, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, it should be a, I really want to see, like, the sort of, I want to see that this guy, the Witcher, is a kick-ass dude because he's killing this totally intimidating badass monster, right? And I feel like we need to have, like, real imposing muscle structure that this guy's back needs to say a lot about him. He's got the scars and things, and that's progress, but I think that he needs to have, like, I'm going to pull up some reference of, like, a muscular back, because I don't even know where to start. I mean, ta-da, cheat sheet. So, what I'll probably do is pull this in here, and I'm just looking at it for structure. This guy's clearly flexing in a different way, so it's not going to be identical. But I'm going to have these next to each other on the screen at the same time so that I'm pulling from reality in some ways. And I'm going to first, I think, take all these brights down because it's just too bright. I think that the brightest point on here can be, you can give it a decent amount of light. Like, you want them to pull off the background to a degree. I think one of the cheapest tricks is he's already got a little smoke in here. I usually, if I want to pull some guy, if I want to pull him off of there, I usually just take white and I use my big cloudy brush. I hit it across the whole thing and then mask it back.
Mm-hmm. Even if you added the more darker values, it also gained a lot of more depth to the picture, depth. And it's more from the first, you know, touch with more darker values. It's also making a better division of values in the plans.
Yeah, and early in this blockout stage, if I'm doing something more conceptual, I do use a little bit broader set of tools than just that round brush. See, I'm like erasing back with a soft brush to make sure that we don't lose too much detail in Mr. Witcher here. So I'm looking at the thumbnail and I'm seeing between the smoke and the dark, like, the value structure is changing a lot really quickly. And we're really not losing detail in this guy. We're really just rebuilding this high pass. So I'll probably want some of that, probably want some of that black blood in there still.
To the people who are watching us, do you have any questions to Peter?
Oh yeah.
If you have the ones, please write in below the YouTube video, and I am sure that he will reply to it. So don't hesitate to just ask.
Yeah, you know, I actually take questions all the time from people who contact me through anything. The questions, I'll take questions on literally anything. The ones that I don't like, and I don't want to be defined by the things I don't like, but I do want people to ask good questions. Don't ask, what do you think of my work? Because my question back is always, what do you think of your work? Because, like, people have different creative goals, and they have different creative, you know, it's like, you know, I look at someone's work sometimes, and often I don't know what the intent of it is. Do they really love it, like adventure stories, and that's why they want to have all these muscular guys with their shirts off, or do they think muscular guys with their shirts off is what sells? And it's like, if you look at your own work and you go, I don't know, I don't think it's that good, like, then what am I going to tell you that's going to change your mind? You know? If someone is doing work that they don't love and they don't care about, I'm not going to look at it and go, like, dude, you have it. You are there. Like, so typically when people ask me, like, what do you think of my work? It's always like, well, you know, I think that's the wrong question. Like, I think it doesn't matter what some random dude on the internet thinks of your work. Like, whether I like it or not doesn't really impact anything about your life or your work or your creative decisions. It's like...
It's more like giving the specific tips or just things
that... God, I'm trying to think of a good question. Like, sometimes people just want to start a conversation, like... Hey there, I'm between these different points in my life. I'm thinking about going back to school. I'm thinking about, like, taking this one particular course. I graduated from this school, and I realized I really hate what they do, but I'm not sure I love what I do yet. Like, when it's a conversation, I feel like I really love talking to people, but I really don't like the, what do you think of my work? It's like, I don't know, looks pretty good. Like, It's hard to have input. Like, what do you think? What do you think of it? What do you think about art? What do you think about making art? Like, what do you love about art? What do you want to do? Like, I don't know. It's so personal. Like, art is like this personal expression. You are telling, you're taking something out of your head, like your thoughts and ideas and your fantasies, and you're sharing them with people out loud. Like, you're standing on a stage and you're saying something. I guess we're standing on a stage and saying things right now, but so often I feel like student work is all about trying to make somebody else happy. But it's this opportunity to, like, tell people about all the stuff that you love and care about and that fill up your brain all the time when you're sitting around thinking, like.
Yeah, that's so true. I often, like, encounter a lot of people that are that may have pretty nice skills, but they do not have an opinion about anything. They are just doing what's cool, and it's just that they work tend to be dead, and they do not express that much as they could. Maybe they cannot even answer, like, what do I like? What's cool about that? What's cool about, I don't know, something different? What drives me, right? What makes this thing look cool from this thing? Like, if you are, like, going for a walk and just looking at different stuff, if there would be another person, it would that person would care for different things. Like, I like how the sun goes through the, like, leaves or something, and another person would love how the snow looks like or anything. It's just an opinion, right, that you have to have to be interesting, I think. Because sometimes it's better to have an opinion that is strange than to do not have it at all. I think it's just better to express anything than express nothing. Yeah, so...
If it's winter time right now and outside is a lot of snow, and if you love the way that the snow looks on the ground, why wouldn't you paint that? Why wouldn't you go and do something that represents that fascination and that love of that thing? You know, why would you go paint a sci-fi? I mean, if you want to paint a sci-fi environment, it's like it should be an expression of, like, your ideas about the future and what you want to see there or what you're scared of. And it's an allegory for these, for things that you like or don't like about the world today. Like, it's an opportunity to say something. Like, all sci-fi and fantasy is like metaphor for things in a way of expressing complicated ideas in a more simplified manner. And it's so little of it is about, like, these genre conventions. I get so disappointed when I see all this work that's just the same genre stuff. Like, because it's like, okay. Like, what does an orc mean to you?
Tolkien. How can you relate to it?
Yeah, like, if you know that there's people in the world who are, like, ugly and scary to you and you feel like you can't relate to them, like, that's what an orc is. You know, when Tolkien wrote Lord of the Rings, like, so much of that was about his experience during, during war and trying to escape that and trying to put it in a way that was digestible and sensible, like clearly defined sides of good and evil were so much easier to escape to than the realities of people killing each other. Mm-hmm. And like that's where you get things like orcs and elves from. And it's not because they're just cool to look at. Like it's a expression of real thoughts and ideas from somebody who had real life experience. And,
That's true. I was recently going through an additional material to Lord of the Rings. There's like 24, 25 hours of documentary behind the scenes of the making the movie, and it was really cool to see one of the first of them, which was about Tolkien creating his world, and he was so obsessive about not creating a metaphor for anything by creating, you know, the Lord of the Rings. It's not metaphor for, like, Mordor isn't like a Germany during the war or anything. It's just mythology more than like than a metaphor. I just reminded myself that when you were talking about orcs and how you can really relate to them, are they mean anything or does they mean anything or not? And I just think Tolkien wanted to create just really isolated mythology that would work with a, you know, like an organism, independent organism, without any context. And that's why it works so, you know, I'm talking about it because I was really stoked by these documentaries about him, and it's really cool to watch, and make sure to check it out. It's just an additional material from an extended edition of Lord of the Rings. There's plenty of cool stuff for concept artists, for storyboard artists, for anyone who would love to see the process of creating these movies. They were really crazy, crazy stuff to make. Yeah, what I'm seeing right now, you are simplifying a lot of the things, right? Because they tend, in the picture, they looked a little bit complicated, like a lot of contrast was going on.
In a lot of cases, it's trying to turn the form. You know, you've got this belt going over this guy's chest, and it doesn't represent, like, if he was just wrapped around a tube, it wouldn't be lit like this. You know, I'd probably bring out the light in the front a little bit. I'd probably darken it a little bit as it goes around the side. Try to find where it terminates a little bit more cleanly. It seems like it's turning back up towards the shoulder pad, but I think that going around the form, we probably want it to cut all the way over.
One more question. You are offering mentorships, right?
Yeah.
What can you tell about it? Like, what's your experience with that? How do you like having, like, students, or you treat it in different way? How does it work for you? Is it like a for how long have you been a mentor? Have you been, like, offering mentorship programs?
I started off by working with a couple of people for free because I knew I wanted to do mentorships, but I didn't want to start charging people a bunch of money if I had never done it before.
Mm-hmm.
I started off by working with a few people for free, and I'm still working with one of them, and we've and over time, a lot of it, the discussion is about, like, creative intent. What do we want to get out of this piece? What artists do we need to look at? What content do we need to look at to figure out what this piece needs in order to be as successful as possible?
Mm-hmm.
What's the audience? How is this stuff going to get sold? How is it going to get presented online? You know, it's not about comment and critique on the pieces individually as much as it is about sort of holistic view at as a, you know, being an artist and making a living as an artist and putting together a body of work as a creative individual. And the people who have been attracted to the mentorship so far, the people I just started working with, a lot of them are people who already have a lot of the technical knowledge, and they are really trying to push their portfolio. They don't know how to push their portfolio forward. They know they're missing something, but they don't know what it is. Mm-hmm. And a lot of that comes back to the stuff I was just talking about and figuring out, you know, what are you going to say as an artist? Where are your real influences? Where do those influences come from? And mm-hmm. Oh, I realized about my working on the wrong layer the whole time. Aha. You know, like establishing good habits and things like that. And it's hopefully it's not just about teaching painting techniques. Hopefully I don't even the girl I've been working with the longest, Rebecca Yanovskaya, she doesn't even paint. She works in ballpoint pen. Like we talk through possible technical stuff, but I don't know anything about ballpoint pen. So even without that, it's been a really super productive time that we spent together. And she's gone from being unpublished and nearly unemployable to selling large pieces for lots of money, which I'm super proud of.
You must be proud of her, right?
Super proud. Super, super proud. She's amazing. Yeah. Like she had this amazing ability with ballpoint pen before I met her. Like I can take no credit for that. I saw this. I was like, you're amazing. You're an amazing artist. She's like, then how come I'm unemployed? How come I can't get anyone to hire me for even $100 jobs at Fantasy Flight? And I was like, because that's not you, you know? That's not your dream. That's not what you want. You shouldn't be working towards getting magic cards. There's a different world out there for you, and I could help you find it. And we ended up working together, and she's been doing unbelievably. Like,
ballpoint pen can be it's so unforgiving that you have to have so much dexterity in your hand to you know, provide a decent line. It's crazy how hard it is.
And she's doing photorealistic rendering in it, and then she started adding gold leaf on top of it. Let me pull this up. I gotta plug her again because she's my favorite.
Yeah, it's similar to inking, right? In terms of unforgiving, like how unforgiving that medium is, like you have to have pure skill. Yeah, this stuff is just it's Mooka, right?
yeah, she's Mooka's a big influence. She's been working on a short series, and she used mulled gold for the shadowed gold areas, and this is. She's also a big Royo fan. This was a sort of more inspired by Royo than by Mooka, but like this is something that she'd done before I'd even met her. You know, this is actually the first piece I ever saw her do, and I was at illustration masterclass, and she. Everyone else is doing oil paintings, and there's this one girl sitting there with ballpoint pen meticulously rendering out on one sheet of paper the entire week. And I was like, seeing it come together, I was like, this is completely crazy. Like, I can't believe. Like, I thought she must have been some sort of rank amateur, that she was too scared to use real tools. And then she goes and blows me out of the water with this piece. And I was like, how can you do this and not get work? And she's like, I don't know.
That's crazy.
She's still unemployed, but she's been getting people to give her private commissions, and she's been selling originals. Mm-hmm. And makes way more money than doing magic cards. Mm-hmm. Way better at business if you can get into it. But
yeah, it's a little bit like a fine art world.
Yeah,
world,
yeah,
right?
It's harder.
And all the exclusive ones.
Yeah, it's so much harder than getting commercial work to do that. And
yeah, because you have to get an audience, but then you have to prove them that your work is worth hanging, right? And then you have to tell them that 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 is worth your work.
Yeah,
it's crazy hard.
And not only that, but there's how many of those people are out there? People who are willing to spend thousands of dollars on a piece of art. And then you've got to make sure that your art appeals to them. Like, there's a lot of commercial projects out there with a lot of art directors. It's a rotating staff in a lot of cases with game studios. So there's a lot of opportunities for someone to just like your work, like the flavor of it, and hire you. Oh, man, in fine art, like, it's such a narrow market. You've got to really kill it. You got to be doing something really unique, and you've got to be tickling just the right person just the right way.
Yeah.
I'm trying to pump up the contrast a little bit on the main figure right here, because this is where that contrast is really going to really be working for the piece. Probably in the eye, around the eyes, we want to get a really super tight, super expressive face. Like, this is like, the fact that this face is kind of weak and that the eyes don't look realistic, and even if he's going to be a little bit unnatural in the face because he's, you know, a witchery, it's like, this needs to get sold to hell and back. This is I've skipped this because, I mean, this is like a big creative decision. This mouth is like having each of the teeth with the lines in between them, having the brow cut straight to black as it like turns this sort of hard corner. There's just stylization choices in here that don't jive with the rest of the piece, and this is like, I don't even want to do any kind of paint over on this. Like, if the artist is watching, like, get reference. Have a really clear vision on what kind of face you want to make and what the expression's going to be. And, like, you look at those Witcher games, and that the face for that guy must have been reworked 1,000 times before they committed to the model. So that is, like, if every part of this piece kind of sucks, but the face is killer, people will still like it.
Mm-hmm. So there are questions on the chat, on the YouTube to the Peter. Peter, do you have any suggestions for a beginner starting to learn these fundamentals, like art books? Maybe it's also, you know, associated to what you have told a minute ago about the fundamentals. Can you extend a little bit about references to learn for people because they are asking?
Oh, sure. Well, you know, James Gurney, I really like James Gurney's Color and Light book a lot, because the way it breaks down is each spread is like a different artistic tool, and so much of learning fundamentals is learning a lot of tools that you can all employ at different spots as they make sense. And to have a book broken down in that format is so much more digestible than a lot of the other materials that are out there. Even though it's a lot of the same fundamental stuff you're going to read everywhere, I think that's a good one. I learned so many fundamentals so late.
So like, you got experience by doing actual
job. Doing and doing.
Yeah, and being really self-critical, like, is this the thing I want to do? Is like working it until it's as good as I can figure out how to make it, and then researching to figure out how to push past that point. Because if you don't reach the limitations of what you're capable of doing when you put your whole self into it, like, I don't know if you really do a ton of learning. You know,
it's also about, you know, just observing, not only just practice. A lot of observing, I always tell the people who are asking for, you know, just some tips, it's about observing and analyzing what you see and trying to, you know, fit it into your pictures and introduce the fundamentals you also have seen, not only you practiced.
Yeah, and I, for the longest time, because I was really bad at studying classical art, I didn't have a lot of reference books that I liked. I wanted to draw everything out of my head. I wasn't using reference for a long time. I would just be obsessively looking at everything around me, at cloudscapes, at people, and trying to just remember every little detail that I saw and put it away. And that process was happening 24 hours a day. Well, you know, when I was really getting started, when I was really becoming obsessed at first, that was the thing to do. And so, that's never gone away.
Another question, when do you know you're finished with the piece? Like, is there any, like, blessing of God coming through the clouds and then you know it's finished, or it's just a planned out thing?
Whenever I look through the whole piece and I'm looking at every element individually, like if the ears, if the way the hair is done, if the back of the neck, if the musculature on the back, if the scars, if every individual element I look at and go, so sick of this. Like as soon as I hate everything in it, and I know I've worked every element to the best of my ability, and that doesn't mean that it looks perfect to me, because most of the time when I'm at that point where I've worked it to the best of my ability, I'm sick of looking at it and I hate the way it looks. Mm-hmm. When I get that feeling about every single element, then it's done.
So
it's the total opposite of what I would think.
You think
so? You are not feeling complete. You are feeling much more like frustrated and incomplete.
When I know I am at the limit of how good I can possibly make it with all my knowledge and resources, that's the point when it's done, and it's so sickening to look at it at that point. Mm-hmm. So, because you still get this sense of what's wrong about it.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Your vision and your taste is much more ahead of your skills, and you just have to wait until it kicks in, right?
Oh, yeah, and it's mentally very challenging because you look at it and you're so disappointed in every bit of it. And when you're like when you're completely disappointed with every piece of it, like then you know, yeah, that's done. That's done. Time to move on.
Yeah, so it's going beyond being happy about certain parts of it. It's working it through that to the part you like mastered it and you can do better, but yeah, like you can envision it better, but not actually do. So yeah, that's a good point.
When you are sick of it, when you're just totally sick of it, like. That's a good spot. Like, but no, there's a point where you're sick of it, but you know it's not done. You're like, I could do better than this. Oh, this is just, you look at something, you're like, this is wrong. Research will fix this.
Yeah.
You know, you do the research, you do the best you can, but there's a certain point where it is, the painting is like, never going to get better than that. You're like, that's it. That's as good as it gets for me.
So it's all like, it always can be better. It's just a matter of, When you can stop.
Yeah, and sometimes you know when you've got a good one on your hands. It doesn't mean that you hate every painting, but you know you finish a painting. Sometimes you go like, got a good one. This is a banger. I can't wait to get this on Tumblr, on DA, on CG Hub, everywhere. And there's sometimes where you're like, well, didn't work out like a plan, but this is as good as it gets. This is going online. Not gonna get all the hits. It's not gonna win the awards, but you know what? It fills a need for me and for my portfolio. So that's it. That's the end. Oh, so, okay. So I want to mention something about clouds really fast. Clouds are amazing because you can't do them wrong, except if they work. They because you can put the lights and darks wherever you want to make the painting more effective. If you're gonna have a guy with white hair, don't put white clouds right behind his head. There's no reason. So you wanna mat your cloud patterns to complement the foreground as much as possible. And you see this all the time in classic paintings, in
Frazetta, kind of.
Vallejo, in Frazetta, you see these awesome, majestic, abstract cloudscapes, and like their patterns are these brilliant abstract designs. And this is, you see a lot of painting clouds in the backs of my paintings because I love just doing this sort of loose abstract design, this textural painting. And then you just get to do, you get a free pass on getting it all to fit together right. Because when you have figures that need to all fit together, like, you may have a problem where the composition's getting screwed up by the position of an arm, but then if you move the arm, the gesture breaks. But with clouds, it's like, sweet, I'll just paint this cloud exactly where it needs to be now.
Yeah.
Done. Easy. No problem. So, like, don't... If you're going to have a bright sword and a bright hair, just put some dark clouds behind that guy. Make him pop out. Clouds are
There's another question to you, Peter. It's you told us about your painting in values only, but there are any exceptions to this? Just starting with a color sketch or thumbnail?
Nope.
Okay.
Really. back in time, I used to do straight into color, but what would happen is I'd have to lay down layers and layers and layers of color to build up to the color I really wanted. Mm-hmm. It was just a waste of time. Like, I've had much better success as I've segregated the color stage from the mm-hmm. rest of the work. I want this guy's leg to pop out in front of this fog for no reason.
So, did it happen that you've sent for to Wizards or any other clients more than one sketch with composition? You know, some kind of package with sketches, or there's only the one sketch you like and they pick it up or not?
Usually, nowadays with Magic, I typically just send over one sketch. Like, mm-hmm. if a client doesn't ask for it, I work through a number of sketches and then I pick out the one I like and I pitch it. Mm-hmm. If I'm doing concept work, I'll maybe pitch more than one, but... I get stuff rejected, but I typically don't work up a bunch of work that I think is going to get thrown out.
How have you got like your first gig at Wizards?
I'm at the art director at a convention.
Oh, so it's a
natural way.
Yeah. Natural way, which is impossible in Poland.
Yes, definitely.
It's like people are like, oh, how do you get noticed by Wizards? Well, if you say hi to them, they tend to notice you. if you wave your arms in front of their face and say, hey, do you got a minute? Like, that's usually an attention-grabbing technique.
That usually works for any kind of person.
Yeah, pretty much.
Even not Wizards.
You know, getting in an opportunity where you're going to meet someone either through an online chat or through face-to-face, like, is good. Like, that's it. It's easy. Like, you're in a room, you get to tell them whatever you want, you get to show them whatever you want, and then they get to make the choice about whether or not they want to work with you. Mm-hmm. The end. Like, I recently got an art director from a place I wanted to work at showing up to an online class that I was a part of, and he was talking with us, and he was looking at my work, and mm-hmm. I gave him all my contact info and my latest portfolio. Mm-hmm. And it's like, all right, well, you know, if I don't get it, that's my fault. Because my work's not good enough. Because, I feel like so many people blame their not getting work with their dream client because they can't tell the person that they exist. But nowadays, it's really easy to just find someone's email and email them, like, a couple of JPEGs and, like, a little thing that says, hey, I want to work with you. Like, it's not, like, you're not,
it's
like,
not an excuse
dating anymore. Him. You're not asking him for sex. You're just saying, like, you're not, like, going to ruin your friendship by, like, asking him something inappropriate. You're like, you are a business person and I want to work with you. It's like...
Yeah.
Business things, right?
It's like,
only business.
Yeah, only business. This is
nothing personal.
Territory. Yeah. Like, it's not. They're not going to be like, "Whoa, dude, what?
Get the fuck out of my email."
This is not how you talk to people. You don't ask them to work. You don't ask a business person to work with them. It's like,
no way, man.
No way. What would you? You're some kind of sicko? You just go up to someone from your portfolio?
Yeah. All right. So it's pretty straightforward.
It's straightforward. Most people don't get work with Wizards because they never submit their portfolio. I've talked to many people who have asked me the question. I say, hey, here's the email of the guy. And they're like, can you recommend me? I was like, this guy's really busy. He doesn't want to see what your recommendation emails. Just send over your portfolio. And they just don't. Mm-hmm. They just don't submit.
Don't hesitate to make it.
Yeah. And then they say, oh, I submitted once 3 years ago and I didn't get anything back. It's like, really? Just send it again. Like, they don't remember.
Mm-hmm.
Send over work they want to see and that'll be it.
Fight for it.
So there's a question to all of us guys. What do you think is better for creating art? Warmer or colder climates?
What? Colder.
Colder.
Yes. Stuck indoors.
Yeah, Wojtek?
Wait, I didn't understand the question. Let me see it on YouTube.
I think I can see the Q&A tab on the side here.
Warmer or colder climate?
Yeah.
Okay, I get it. Okay, in terms of, yeah. I tend to do both. I don't know. I tend to do some sweet pictures, but also I like like nitty gritty kind of a sci-fi look. I tend to go both ways. Like the latest like experiment in style I did recently, it's like freaking burning everybody's monitors because it's all freaking red. And then I go for like totally muted, not using any saturated colors. Yeah, and like I said to you, Peter, I'm a total like an opposite of you in terms of technique. I tend to try every fucking thing, like just everything, and it ruins my brain because I tend to think, oh, I can do it like that, I can do it like this, and okay, custom shapes, freaking brushes, freaking 3D, freaking replicators, freaking fucking everything, like mixer, brush tool, everything, right? I'm just getting overwhelmed with a tool, and sometimes even forgetting about like foundation thing and straightforward process. So that's why it's so cool for me to be here today and look at the way you work and maybe narrow things down and answer some questions in my head. What the hell do I want, really want, right? That's important. Yeah, so
yeah,
I got another one here from the Facebook group I want to poke at a little bit. But yeah, everyone's works really different, though. I mean, I don't think that my method is the best, but...
Yeah, but it's refreshing that, like, for me to see you... see your very like your process very narrow.
You are pretty patient.
Yeah, patient guy, which I am not.
Yes, exactly.
Like I'm totally freaking jumping all over the place, and you know, and I just love learning new things. You know, I just love discovering how the things are done and like how the hell that the certain like even movie effects did, and how can I apply it to my work. I'm very like non-linear in terms of my work. I tend to go like jumping around, like doing some experiments, and that's what makes me, you know, once I do photo bash thing, then I experiment with depicting like a oil effect in Photoshop, then I go into merging these two things, and I go into 3D, then I go into... And maybe it's more of a concept kind of a thinking, and
it's also about the personality.
Totally.
I have pretty similar to you, Wojtek, with just rushing. That's why I love just speed painting pictures. And when you see me the first time, you saw my workflow and how my Photoshop is, you know, just every window is pumped. Popping around.
Yeah, I was
it looked exactly like my room, so it's kind of personality, but you have to, you know, force yourself sometimes to get a bit longer, stay with the work and trying to polish it up. It also depends on the work you have to do.
Yeah,
but
exactly.
But what you feel is, you know, more natural is just experimenting with the stuff and making everything pretty fast. So that's what I also admire with in Peter's work, that how long and how precise he is while working.
Yeah.
And it's you know, just I don't know, it's what he feel, but I would be pretty, you know, just I would be crazy if I would stay like this. And okay, I will stroke here, here, and here. No fucking way, yeah.
Oh, so, Peter, can you repeat how you did that effect with selecting the channels and duplicating them?
Oh, yeah. So that's control.
Control Alt.
And that gives you a dynamic selection of the RGB channel. You can select the channels in the channel tab.
Okay, so that's just a simple channel selection, right?
Yeah, it's just a simple channel select, and then I do a copy merge, which is Shift Control C, mm-hmm. and then I do and I paste that selection, which is Control V, and that makes a new layer. And you can see what this layer looks like against white, mm-hmm. which is that the selection is not really grabbing the whites at all. So mm-hmm. It's grabbing stuff. The darker it gets, the more it grabs it. Or no, wait, sorry. I'm sorry. I hit that reversed. The lighter it gets, the more it grabs it, and the darker it gets, the less it grabs it.
Uh-huh.
And then, so you can see against black, it's just the light as it gets lighter, but it's like catching these saturated midtones in here. So when you remultiply it over the image, you get this sort of... It saturates things, but you can see what it's doing to these background colors. Like, look at this. Like, it goes from this kind of lots of white mixed in uh-huh. with a little bit of pigment to, like, there it is. Like, there's that. There's those actual
color. Actual color, yeah.
Yeah. And if stuff starts to feel kind of washed out, and this is true of paintings and photos, you can bring those back in. And it affects those middle tones the most. Mm-hmm. So it saturates and darkens the middle.
Okay, so what are the issues you see in that work?
This painting has a couple of different problems. One of them is too much use of white and black for mixing colors. So we're getting, lots of these lighter areas are getting very washed out. So it's not allowing the piece to have a lot of variation between the warms and cools to give it a balance. Mm-hmm. The playing warm and cool colors off each other is such a powerful tool that eliminating it from your usable set of things that you're doing is just so limiting. It tightens in on what tools it puts all of that need of expression onto other stuff. So you need to like make the contrast higher and make the values punch more, and it's just like use everything you can out of a piece. And with a very monochrome piece like this, I definitely want to get more balance between the warms and the cools, especially in the grays, to be able to describe both the materials and the composition and all sorts of stuff. I think that there were some basic things off. Like, I really like this simple head with the texture and stuff, but the suggestion of the head and where the eye hole is don't seem to really be lining up. So I'm just trying to, like, tighten little details, trying to follow the shape of the head rather than reshape the head to follow the eye. I think that building in some very clear definition into these simple shapes is going to add tons of interest to this piece. I've done a billion characters without faces, and I gotta tell you that this, when you don't do the face, everything around it needs to be tight.
Yeah, that's true.
So this weird loose collar thing, like, yes, okay, frayed cloth, got it. Loose brush strokes do not look like frayed cloth. This material needs to be established. This means if you don't know what it looks like, you need to look up reference. If you've done this a million times before, you can probably fake it.
Mm-hmm.
You've got these mixture of these hard triangles, making the folds in the cloth. Try to wrap the whole thing around the body. If we've got light coming in from down over here, that means we're probably going to need to wrap the lighting around a little bit. Probably going to bring up some of the, if we want this to be a warm gray, we're probably going to give it a little, maybe push a little closer to middle to bounce off of those cools. Probably lighten it up a bit too. Finding the right gray. Gray can be any color in the spectrum as long, depending on context. Gray is like a wild card. You know.
Depends on the context, right?
Yeah, it's like a blank letter in Scrabble. It's like any place that you put it, it fills in depending on the context. It's really cool. Gray is a super powerful color. But it has to be used with clear intention. The edges on this head are totally weak. Gotta tighten this up because this is storytelling right here. And this is, you know, this is where people are going to be resting and, like, looking into the piece to find interest in it. So tight edges are going to make a big, big difference in that part. I don't like the look of a lot of these custom brush strokes, these repeating edges here. Like for a speed paint, it's okay for an illustration.
Yeah, it's repeating and repeating the shapes the same.
Yeah, this was the wrong brush to use right here.
Mm-hmm.
It'd be fixed by just going, trying to sample out the color that you want out of it, and then just going back over it, just solid. That's a step you don't want to have to do. Like, this is a bummer to have to go through a painting and clear out tool marks.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you want to be building on stuff. You want to render it. You want to light it. You want to be, you know, adding detail to it. You don't want to be meticulously going in and cleaning out your tool marks. That's such a bummer. But if that's what has happened in your painting and you want to finish it, that is what you need to do. So you do the bummer work so that you can get back to the good stuff.
There is a question about art school.
Sure.
Do any of you attended one?
I did.
Yeah, me. I'm just a student in Academy of Fine Art.
But it was any use? Like,
to be fair, not really.
For you, no, Peter.
I didn't like the school I went to or the program I had. Uh-huh. I think art school can be useful, but mine wasn't. I disliked it quite a bit.
Alright.
I used the time while I was there to learn. I taught myself most of the painting stuff that I'm demonstrating while I was in college. Mm-hmm. And that was just deconstructing paintings from people online and posting them on DeviantArt to get feedback.
So would you go to art school again? Like, if you would redone your career, would you go?
Oh, yeah. I'd go back to art school today if I could. Because there's the idea of, like, working for myself and just building a portfolio for myself sounds amazing. Like, I have so much fun working on art. And oftentimes the needs of a commercial piece are not that fun. So the idea of going to art school and having that be my whole life and having my whole life revolve around building portfolio pieces and studying sounds awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
the worst is when you have to, you know, just study and in the same time you are trying to be in freelance or something. It just makes you, know, pretty distracted somehow. It also depends on the climate in school, the conditions, and all that stuff, the teachers. Sometimes it's pretty helpful, but I don't think so. It in my situations was the...
It depends on the school, right?
Yes,
totally depends.
Exactly.
Totally.
Exactly, as Wojtek said, it also depends on school. Sometimes you can pretty meet a lot of nice people, but it also depends how much you are into it, this school. How many times are you spending there and trying to reach the right things? Sometimes I'm going to drawing sessions and it's pretty cool, but most of the time it's, you know, it's only in Poland, but they are pretty conservative and they are not looking for digital painters like real painters. They don't even think that you are...
It's more of a contemporary art.
Yes, they don't even think that you are doing it on your own. They think that the computer works for you. I hate it, that feeling, that opinions. So that's why I just try to get my own path and only finish this one with some basic and people who really inspire me. But it's, you know, I felt that that school will be better than it is. So yeah.
The program matters so much. The program and
yes.
The teacher matter tremendously. Mm-hmm. I didn't know what I was looking for when I was kind of getting out of high school, so I went to one of those trade schools where they try to teach a program in game art, and it was really really, really dumb. I was, like, mm-hmm. learning sound editing and motion graphics and stuff. Like,
yes.
Stupid stuff that has nothing to do with
exactly.
Working in the game business, but you know, if I knew what I know now as far as, like, what kind of programs are out there and what you can be doing in one of these programs, Like, I'd just be spending all day picking away at awesome, like, oil paintings for stuff that really inspired me, surrounded by a bunch of other ambitious artists and sexy art school chicks and, like, inspiring teachers. Like, it would be, like, it would be like a nonstop vacation. It would be amazing. I really would love to go back and do something like that. Even knowing a lot of the stuff that I know now as far as fundamentals and how to make paintings, like, there's so much more I could learn. And to do it full-time as a student just sounds like the best.
So the same situation, I had it when I was in L.A. and visited the Gnome School. It's, you know, just only being in that school is so inspirational because they work, you know, kind of dual, double path. They learn and trying to be good in traditional ways, and also the same way they do it, they try to introduce in digital, so they are not leaving anything. They sculpt, they paint, they draw, and they also make 3D models. They paint on tablet, and nothing is, you know, pretty. It's not like the way it's in Poland is presented. That it's not. You shouldn't do this. The computer is bad and all that stuff. It's all about bullshit. And I was in Gnomon for almost all the day, and I was pretty pumped to work harder on myself. And I would really love to be in there and trying to get some classes, because it's, you know, the modern way of looking how the art will look in maybe next 5 years. They are not that they are pretty, you know, open for all the techniques, so they are not closed for one like in conservative schools. It's amazing.
Yeah, I would love to do a program like that. Oh, as a note from what I'm working on here, like, if you've got a character with no face, you need to paint the living crap out of the hands, and two, don't hide one of the hands. Like, oh my God, you only get so much to act with inside of a piece to give this guy his personality, and like, if he's only got one hand, this is going to be a really tough piece to get this expressive, so, like, this guy needs a second hand so bad. Yeah, I know hands are hard to draw, which is one of the reasons why you need to draw them, like, in every piece.
Yes, hands are pretty nightmare for a lot of paper.
You better have a really, really good reason if you aren't showing both hands of a character.
But like, you don't have to, you know, avoid it. That they are, as you said, that are kind of fundamentals. And if you really know how to learn how to paint them and or draw, you will be doing it with pleasure, and it will just make you, you know, more special, because a lot of people miss the things, putting the gloves or anything on the hand and making them, you know, just kind of caricatural things, and they try to, you know, hide it in the shadows or make only the suggestion that there's the hand in here, but if they are shown pretty well, the people can, you know, just see that you like it, that you pretty can do it, and it's great. The people will respect it.
So what I've been doing here to fix some of these issues is using the lasso tool. I guess I lied. I do use the lasso tool to make corrections. Mm-hmm. And the way I do it is I lasso out the whole area and I cut it, I copy it, and then I repaste it. And using the eraser to, like, and the paintbrush, I can then, you know, meld it back into the painting to be able to move features around. And doing that is, like, critical to resizing heads and hands. Mm-hmm. Like, the hand looked tiny. Doing minor resizes and repositionings on features late in the painting. If you got to do it, you got to do it. So, like, take care of it as soon as you notice it. And then you can push it right back down into your rendering layer. So it doesn't even add to your layer count, really.
Peter, for your reminder, just don't forget to save the PSD, and we can share it with the person who the original painted was. Okay?
Sure. One of the so here's a random trick that I like to try sometimes. It doesn't always work. It's a gradient map called Bronze. Or Copper. It's pre-built into Photoshop. And if you soft light this on a stuff, it sometimes does some really weird stuff to the values. If something feels maybe a little bit too over, like, if the too rounded and you want to, like, add some more dimension into it and some more interest, sometimes adding the copper, or I've got a cool version of copper also. Like, you can see in the background, it's starting to do these interesting things where these smaller light areas are popping through, and it's pushing down these other areas. So it's doing cool stuff to the background, but it's not doing cool stuff to the character.
So are you using a lot of color balancing and correcting after you have the refined piece? You think that it's, you know, pretty finished, but after that you are playing around with various things like hue and saturation, color balance. Do you do it often, or is it occasionally?
On occasion. I mean, I do make a pass to make sure that the values and the color balance are where I want it. I want to make changes like this, where I'm pushing the background back and sort of making the values more interesting with this adjustment layer. I want to do this early. You know, I'll do like a selective color, because if the blacks are getting too black, selective color to colorize the blacks a little bit. You know, this one cool thing going on, adding some red into the blacks is going to give them a little bit of life. Maybe even doing a little, grabbing some super saturated red and going into the deepest blacks to do like a super black areas. When stuff goes past black, I like to pick a color that is like blacker than black, where instead of going all the way to the pixel on the screen being lit up zero amount and it's just matte black, I prefer instead to start adding a super saturated color into that space. So black is near black, and then black is like red or something else, just to make it so that those darker colors don't all crush together into a big blob.
It's kind of enriching the things.
Yeah, and sometimes it just takes a little bit. Sometimes you can put a lot of color inside your blacks and get a really cool effect. It depends. It creates a certain look that sometimes I'll do this and I'll go, oh, okay, that's really good, and I'll paint on it for another few hours. And I'll look at it and go, ugh, it's kind of muddy and weird. What's wrong with the colors? And I'll pull it off and I'll go, oh, okay, way better. And I'll realize that was a big mistake and I'll just skip it. It depends on the piece. It depends on your taste. Depends on the day of the week. You know, you got to work it until you're sick of every little tiny bit of it. So...
Guys, we have like 2 hours on the timer. 2 hours and 10 minutes. Peter, we don't want you to, you know, take you away from your work. So let us know whenever you will have to, you know, do your thing.
Well, Sunday I'm unemployed, but I do have a meeting later about a thing. So
yeah, I think we can wrap up in like 10 or 15 minutes. Maybe just let's answer some questions, and I think we will be done, because you know, we were planning to do some overpaintings from our own, like from me and Darek, but turned out that you are doing such a great job at answering questions and, you know, pointing out certain things, that it would be just a waste not to let you do your thing.
Exactly.
That's really amazing. So Darek, let's see if we have any more questions.
Okay. Coming. There is a question that I think it was a bit it will be a bit repetitive, but the question to Peter about your idea Do you always have an idea or a mental image in my in your mind when you start painting, or do you end up painting somewhat randomly and see what comes out?
I've done both, but when I paint randomly, I'm less satisfied with it, and the results are less tend to be less good. I've got some paintings that I like and that have been recognized or published that people comment on a lot. But the problem with it is that I don't feel anything about them. Like, it's a bit of a bummer to have a painting that people compliment all the time, but I, like, don't care about very much. So I really prefer to have an idea. I think it enriches the painting so much, and it makes me feel better about the whole process, and it makes me feel better about the end results, too.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like I have every reason to want to have an idea.
Mm-hmm.
A thought behind the painting before I start going into it.
Another question for you, Peter. Can you give us some advice how to apply studies? It's a question from the chat.
How to apply status?
Yes.
What do you mean by status?
I don't know what he was meant. Maybe he will explain it. Okay, there is another question for that moment. Which school program would you go for now if you went to the school, Peter?
I'd probably talk to the people who are most involved in education that I know. I'd talk to Rebecca Gay and Dan DeSantos. I would talk to some recent graduates that have been doing really well, like Sam Wolf Connolly, who's only a few years out of college. I personally, since I didn't have a good educational experience, I don't have anything firsthand. I knew a lot of people who were going to SCAD, Savannah School of Art and Design, when I was living in Atlanta, and that seemed like a cool program, but I don't know. I would end up just doing a lot of research and trying to find some place that rang all the right bells as far as knowing I was going to be able to do imaginative painting. It wasn't going to be a fine art program, while staying away from any kind of trade schools that offered a lot of assignments that were too much like commercial work. I wouldn't want to go to a school that was specifically for getting into games. I think that anything that's aimed at games or the film industry or any kind of commercial industry is missing the point and probably not worth going to. I really like the description of Gnomon because it seemed to be more of a...
Mm-hmm.
Seemed to be a commercial focus towards the end result, getting people prepared for working as commercial artists, it sounded like the program... was very well rounded and involved a lot of classes.
Yeah, and the text it takes a lot of issues in Gnomon. That is, you know, just this, as I said, it's sculpture and painting and all that stuff. It's, you know, you will be much more various on different positions. So it's great.
Yeah, I would want a school that has some forces you to do some really tedious fundamental training like cast drawing,
mm-hmm.
but also understands the value of making, mm-hmm. Letting students work through expressive painting, you know, from their imagination.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That seems like it could be a tough balance. There's some schools that have been really good at that in the past and
yes.
have developed a reputation. You have to really check to make sure that they haven't fallen off the wagon over the past few years,
mm-hmm,
you know?
Mm-hmm.
There's been a big change to the program, or a lot of teachers have left.
Exactly.
But even if you go to a program and it's not what you want, you're still surrounded by artists, you're still working on art every day, you're surrounded by art tools and resources. Like, I went to a crap school that didn't even have tablets until the last year I was there.
Me too.
and what I did is I bought my own tablet, and I used the time that I was being supported to just make art and that was the only thing that was expected of me to make a lot of art. And I learned a lot during that time, even though I wasn't getting a lot of instruction from the program. So someone who's already in an art program, don't use it as an excuse why you're you're doing poorly if you're not satisfied.
It's just the same, like you just start making pictures on tablet and you have pretty strong basics on and your knowledge in, you know, the program and or software you want to use to make a digital painting is also, you know, just some things are, you know, pretty well known by you. But I, from my point of view, I have started digital painting when I was only working as a hobbyist on the paper with pencil and pen for a lot of years from childhood, and putting myself and diving into the digital paintings, it was like, you know, just knowing everything from zero. It was the first, you know, thing where I started serious work with colors and learning and understanding the things like brush strokes and all the fundamentals with perspective and all that stuff. So that's why I think it's kind of a pretty similar way working on tablet, because it was the first real paintings technique which I started. So maybe maybe only me, but that's what I pretty think that is pretty connected. Just a regular painting and digital painting. If you adjust your software to the traditional way of working.
Yeah.
And Peter, we have another questions.
Sure.
And I think we can just reply to this question about studies. It's about just applying studies. So I can think that it's about making some studies and using your knowledge in your commercial work. How do you apply your knowledge of your studies, which you've made, I don't know, years ago, or just from time to time you make it to your commercial work? How the way it looks in your situation?
I didn't do any studies throughout my entire education, and I didn't ever. I've done very few in my life, and I learned by. I definitely looked at lots of art, but I recommend people do studies, but I did not do them. I learned by just making a lot of bad paintings. I made so many bad
paintings. So you are the exception you made.
Yes.
That makes this rule works, I think.
Yeah, it's only a rule if there's someone who doesn't follow it. So it's. I really recommend people do studies. I look at some of these classic paintings and I see the edge control. I want to put them in front of someone who has very little knowledge about edge control and say, here, just copy this painting. You'll see what you're missing. There it is. It's right there. And I think that would help a lot. Man, if I could go back in time and redo it, I'd be a lot better at painting today. But instead, I just muddled through and just I didn't do any studies.
Maybe because you are so good at looking at stuff and making some points from just observation.
Mm-hmm.
Because what studying is just looking closer, I think. It's just
observing and analyzing. So
yeah, exactly. Because you have to reconstruct, you have to pay attention. And maybe you are just talented in looking at stuff and absorbing stuff that surrounds you. And all the fluctuations and all the different, you know, details, you're just absorbing it.
So as Peter just said, he always worked, and it's about the practice. So I think it came naturally to him, to knowing the fundamentals while working, refining his things, and learning from one work to another.
Yeah. You don't really learn something unless you do it.
Mm-hmm.
And I would try to do something in a painting and it would fail, and then I'd have to study and figure out, okay, what do I need to do? What bit of anatomy do I need to learn? What do I need to know about lighting I don't understand? And when I would run into a problem, and then I would see the solution somewhere. It was like a lightning bolt. It would hit me, and I'd get so excited, like, oh, this is how you do it. This is how this works. This would make sense now. But I was relying on sort of the universe to show me solutions instead of actually just looking them up. And that made it so it's taken me, you know, 8 or 10 years to learn some really basic stuff about light and color.
Mm-hmm.
That I think you could learn in a matter of weeks or months if you just go ahead and put mm-hmm. the
focus on certain studies.
Guys, what do you think about using 3D in concept art position industry? It's
yeah, concept art is different, right? Illustration is illustration, concept mm-hmm. art is concept art. Sometimes they mix. Mm-hmm. It tends to sometimes, you know, it tends to overlap, but what 3D does is it breaks unity in mm-hmm. your piece. It just breaks unity, and you have to maintain it, so probably you would have to overpaint it still. Mm-hmm. So it may be a quick fix for your, I don't know, maybe a quick
lighting.
Step ahead when you are planning out your painting. Mm-hmm. It's the same. You could do it with clay, right, and shoot a photo. And mm-hmm. let your like clay models, and it's the same, but you are using just the software for that. It does the thing, but you have to ask yourself, will you use it directly in your piece? So are you copy pasting, like taking a rendered out piece, or you are just basing, like looking for a light reference? Yeah, I see Peter.
Here's a magic card.
Things. This is SketchUp, right?
Yeah. I love mm-hmm. SketchUp because you don't need to be good at 3D to make a SketchUp model.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if you don't know how to model a tree, you just steal one off their resource. So this is a 3D model that I made in SketchUp. The art brief was to make a town hall. I needed to use a particular style of architecture. So I got to steal the motifs from the style guide, but I had to design the building myself. And I painted over it, and I got the final here too.
Amazing. This looks amazing, man.
I am not an environment painter, and there's like a couple of times where they gave me these land cards,
mm-hmm.
and I was like, I need to use every tool that I know how to use in order to get this done.
And you did a freaking awesome job.
Yeah.
I think some of the earlier versions had a better mood, but I had made some adjustments to it, like I had peaked the roof higher and stuff, but for the most part, it was, I had changed the windows and whatever, but I.
So 3D. It's still from like 3D line art to grayscale to gradient map to hard light.
I can break down the layers. Like I made for the rest of the stuff, I even blocked out the clouds just in painting behind it. But I probably would do it different now. But you can see I'm still doing the same thing where I'm trying to work out the values.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, gradient map, hard light to start bringing in some lighting and some colors. I worked on it with some more adjustment layers until I started getting closer uh-huh. to the lighting palette I wanted. I wanted this kind of longer... these shadows to be cast across the top of it while the bottom was being lit, and I wanted these shadows cast from the nearby trees and things. Mm-hmm. And I was able to get those shadows cast by the trees and stuff in the SketchUp, which was great, because...
So you are just playing around with colors without doing any actual opaque painting, right?
So yeah, there's a little bit of opaque painting here. This one was a mess. It was such a mess. I kept going back and forth on like normal and hard light, trying to find like, how do I get this composition to work? How do I put all the elements in that I want? This statue got moved from here to the top and then back down to the front. I had reference for a lot of things, and
mm-hmm.
I was convinced at the end of this whole process that this was the worst painting I'd ever done for a client.
You are
funny as hell, man.
Sick of it. So sick of it. And there's some photo textures in here. But
only
so
one
much of me drawing every individual vine and like coloring in individual windows and all the tiles are just me with a round brush, just working it away, like tiny strokes. And at the end, I'm just like, this is the best I can do. Deadline's over. I'm turning it in. And I thought this was the worst painting I had ever made. And then when it came out, people freaked out. It was a good card. It's a very useful card in the game. And so I started getting people asking me about originals. I was like, originals? 3D models. Like, I'd done this in oil. I would have made, you know, probably around $2,000 selling it on eBay. And I really, if I knew how to do that, I really should have, but I didn't. But I've got a canvas print of it here in my office. Uh-huh. And I've sold a few canvas prints of it because, you know, it's like, I had no idea. I really had no idea it was any good. I was convinced it was terrible. I was dreading it coming out because then people would realize that I was a really bad Magic artist and that they would not want to collect my stuff.
It's another question from chat to you, Peter. With your current skill set, what do you think are your strength and weakness?
I can draw mushy monsters all day long. Humanoid but sort of alien-looking things is like slam dunk. Boom. Do this all day. I can stylize heads, torsos, and arms all day, but I suck at legs. Mm-hmm. So you see a lot of characters that wear, like, kilts or like get cut off at the waist when I draw them, like this and mainly masculine forms. Male. This is it. This is male character, waist up, centered composition. No, like minimal background. I can. Mm-hmm. I am good at that. That's something I have confidence in. Past that, it's all to toss up. It's just hard work trying to get anything done. Mm-hmm.
So I heard you are going to publish your paintings as a book. Is it true? Like summer 2014? That's the info from your website. Is it still like going?
Yeah. This is so. I got fired from my job November, and then I spent December kind of moving and getting reset up in New City. And now I just have everything set up finally as of like this last week in my new house with my new business plan and my new day-to-day, a new office, new desk, new everything. And this is the big project I'm trying to focus on, is making this book, the Angel book, happen.
So will it happen through Kickstarter or?
Yes, definitely.
Oh, so like your previous project with Mats and...
I'm going to be offering the book. The goal is to offer the book plus have some merchandise like prints and maybe some play mats or other stuff associated with it at different reward tiers. And probably a couple different versions of the book, a normal version and a premium version. I don't know yet. I want to get a large chunk of the work done so that I can really sell the idea to the best of my ability.
Yeah, and that's what Kickstarter is good at.
Yeah.
So there is a question about photo bashing. I think it's to all of us. Maybe let's start with Peter or Wojtek. What do you think, guys, how to blend them perfectly to the painting process?
Actually, yeah, you haven't done any of that, right?
Yeah.
Very little. And every time I do it, I think I'm bad at it. I stopped doing it.
So we should maybe switch to my screen.
Okay.
It will take a minute for me to find a file. Mm-hmm. So give me a minute.
I have opinions on photo bashing.
Go ahead. I can predict it. Yeah, go ahead.
I think photo bashing is a very viable tool that is not for everyone.
That's so true.
I think that some people should not photo bash. Like, I'm one of them. Mm-hmm. It doesn't affect me in any negative ways that I'm not a guy who should be photo bashing. And I see people who feel like they need to do it. like it's this is what concept artists do. I must learn mm-hmm. this skill, and it's like airbrush. It's like it's a weird tool that some people do really great stuff with, and not everyone should use. Like that's it. Like if you see some techniques online, you try them out, and you get some really good results.
Wojtek, when you are ready.
You know, actually, let's just move it to the next session because we have a pretty
yes
cool guest that will be joining us during the next session, and he is connected with photo bashing a lot, and I think this
yeah,
session can be more painterly and you know
yeah.
Traditional kind of an illustration approach, and we can
exactly.
tackle photo bash during the next session, and yeah, we will announce the guest.
Yeah, let's focus in the next session.
Yeah,
for now
3 hours. Yeah.
We would really love to thank you, Peter, for participating in that session. I hope
it was
valuable for everyone because yeah. for me it was pretty valuable, and we are pretty happy that we had you with us today.
Yeah. Awesome.
Yes, it was awesome session.
Super inspiring, really.
Yeah. And we have to learn patience from you.
Yeah, man, you are like 3 years old, like painting
yes.
process. Damn, that's crazy.
Yeah. And with
that's
amazing,
persistent.
With
yeah.
amazing result, we have to emphasize.
Yeah, totally. Thank you for your overpaintings also. We were lazy today with Darek, so you did all the freaking job for us.
Yeah. And don't forget to save the PSD. We can share it to the people who paint the original ones,
yeah.
and they will be, you know, pretty. Thanks for your help.
Yeah, and remember to check Peter's site. Maybe Peter, can you just redirect people who would love to see your work or anything? The place they should go when they think of your art.
My personal website is vandalhigh.com. And then you can also find my fan page on Facebook. I'm going to be adding more stuff there all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Follow me on Twitter at Bugmire. We should probably, it's really easy. If you Google my name,
mm-hmm.
and you spell it right, everything pops up. I'm so Googleable. It's
mm-hmm.
great. I've been on doing this internet thing for almost 10 years now, so.
Cool.
Okay,
right.
I think we can also write in your details in the Level Up group.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I hope it was amazing session. So
yeah.
Thank you very much once again. Thank you, Wojtek. And we hope that the next one will be also cool. So
yeah,
stay tuned.
You know, spread the word about
yeah.
us. Like, if you enjoy what we are doing,
Subscribe us, follow us, and share.
Just tell one of your friends who are doing that kind of stuff that, you know, there's that kind of thing that is happening pre-stuff.
Yeah, share the event because your energy and your actions will give us energy for next sessions and willingness to make more. So share it with people, and we are thankful for that.
Yeah, so definitely just share our... I don't know, Facebook group or just an event,
yes,
or YouTube video.
Yeah,
everything will work just fine. And keep submitting your work. And we are trying to figure out how to deal with amount of work that
because
you are submitting. Because there's a lot of stuff to be covered that we are just not able to do. But we are in the process of figuring out. So give us some time, and I hope we will get it covered.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
So,
thank you very much once again.
Critter, this is something a friend of mine made. It's essentially paste bin for art.
Mm-hmm.
What you can do is you can go and upload a piece
mm-hmm.
to Critter, and then you can give out, it makes a link that you can give to people for feedback, and they can draw on your work in the browser
mm-hmm.
and write stuff out to you, and it'll get sent to you. So if you want feedback from someone online, instead of having them download it, bring it to Photoshop, draw on it,
uh-huh.
upload it, and give it back to you,
mm-hmm.
like you can send them this one link, and it will let them draw on it and send it back to you without any downloading or uploading or anything. And you can use it even for secure stuff. It's there's no database that's accessible to the database is all encrypted and secure. Mm-hmm. So you can actually send NDA stuff to people through links, and only people who know that special link will be able to see it.
Oh, great.
And we'll definitely link it over to the group, so that's cool.
Okay, guys, so thank you very much, Peter Mohrbacher, Wojtek Fuss, and Darek Zabrocki.
Yeah, cheers, guys. Bye.
Bye-bye.